Hello everyone and welcome to the channel. I'm Emmanuel, I'm an airline pilot, and today we are sitting in the McDonnell Douglas MD-82 once again in the Fly the Mattock add-on. We have enhanced this one with the FTZM Plus sound pack, and we are currently standing in London Gatwick in the Martin Air MD-82 on our way towards Amsterdam Schiphol Airport. So, just another Amsterdam video, you say? Well, Amsterdam is an absolutely exciting airport, so it really got me over here. Alright then, let's head right into the captain's seat and start getting our airplane prepared for our departure. We're going to start with running the APU because it is rather cold outside. So let's start getting it warm and going. And yes, I did just confuse the APU master with the battery switch up here. Shit happens. Alright then, start pump on and let's go ahead and start up the APU. Alright, in the meantime, let's continue with our safety inspection. So that's the wipers off, landing gear lever down, auxiliary hydraulic pumps down here are both off, the flaps lap lever is up, and speed brake lever retracted, and the entire circuit breakers are checked. Alright then, APU is coming up with the N1 above 35, the APU starter light should go out. Here we go, and then we can go ahead watch this one run up before we start up the electrical power. In the meantime, let's quickly head over into the electronic flight bag, and we are going to run up our flight plan, prepare to get that one ready in the EFF, and for that, initially, let's go to the weight and balance and import the SimBrief OFP. Nope, looks like it hasn't downloaded yet, then let's go for SimBrief straight away. Alright, here we go. So, SimBrief data is in, Martin Air H2 Echo, and we are going to have almost full ATC coverage, assuming nobody's going offline in the time. Alright then, I'm going to go for a tiny bit of extra fuel here. Let's make that like 3000 kilogram per side, just to be on the safe side here. So that's going to be 3000 and 3000. Weather itself is looking quite good today, but let's have a look into the electronic flight folder. And we'll start with the airport weather list down here. So Amsterdam Schiphol is showing little gusts in the tempos, but that's almost down the runway, 25 knots, so that is quite all right. For sure, it's some of the best weather we've had over there since the release of Flight Tempest add-on. And our alternate in Rotterdam is showing the same thing in the forecast, so that is quite all right. All right then, so for the fuel, if we have a quick look down here, we've got 5,320 for takeoff plus 300 taxi. So if we round it up to 6 tons, we're going quite well. Alright, so aircraft and services, we can go ahead in here and surely we can start up the refueling in a moment, but let's get the AC power running first. Alright, here we go. AC power is running, and with that we can go ahead and start the refueling process, and when refueling is running, we can then go ahead and start the boarding after we've conducted our initial checks. So APU is running, and then we can turn on the air conditioning packs, giving us a little bit of warm air. As you can see, it's 9 degrees outside, so by the time we start the boarding, we want the cabin to be nice and warm. Okay then, let's go ahead with our continued test. Right, so that kind of stuff is working, no smoking signs are on, and the refueling is in progress. Very good. Quick look into the cabin temperatures before we let our passengers on board. So, cabin, currently 12 degrees but slowly climbing, so we'll keep a little time in order to start the cabin warming up before we start our passenger boarding. In the meantime, what we can do is to go into the ACAS and initialize that one. So, initialize data, init request. Uh, And here we go. The flight data is uplink. We're also going to go for the flight plan and we are going to get our departure ages. So we are in Echo Golf Kilo Kilo, departure ages and request sent. Very good. So that's the most important stuff for us done. ATIS is here, and it's from 1050 Zulu, expect runway 26 left, transition level 70, that's looking good, and the QNH is 1026, let's go ahead and select that one real quick, 1026 and 1026, perfect, and the flight plan is here as well, very good. Okay, so personally I do like to use the flight plan from here, because not only it gives us the most important data, but most importantly, I don't have to switch views between the electronic flight pack and the FMS all the time. Right, crew message with the estimated weights. That is looking good. Zero fuel, 51 250. So let's go ahead and dial that one in. There you go, 51 250. Cool. Fuel, 6 tons are on board already. Very nice. So fueling went quite quick there. So that means fast modes can go on, and then I would say the cabin should be, yeah, not warming up quite yet, but I do hope that is, well, gonna happen as soon as I turn on the APU bleed. That's gonna help for sure. That is gonna help for sure. You see, I haven't flown the MD-80 in a little while as well, but turning on APU bleed generally does help if you want to warm up the cabin. Just a general observation though. Alright, very good. So that stuff is done. Then let's go ahead with our system tests. So station lighting is set, annunciator lights. We're gonna start with that test right here. And all the lights actually seem to be working. Very good. Then cabin pressurization control lever is in the up position. This is down, this is up. Rudder and aileron trims 3 and 0, so I'm just going to move it a little bit to both sides, just to make sure that they are actually moving as they should. Alright, so, FO, you may head out for the exterior inspection. In the meantime, we're going to start in here. So, landing lights are off. Then, EFIS test. Looking good. Autoland capability test. We'll just take some ILS frequency, preferably non-local. Flight directors on and Autoland. So, Autoland pre-flight test is in progress. In the meantime, while that's happening, we can go ahead and continue over here. Okay, autopilot test. Works as it should. Alright, cool. So, with that, we're pretty much done up there. Last things here is static air is in the normal position and oxygen mask is tested as well. Very good. Cool. So, let's go ahead and run the FMS preflight then before we start up with the rest of our panel. So, what I'm going to do, or what I rather like doing, is I'll take the ACAS on the right hand side, and in here we are going to go for the flight plan. And then on the left-hand side, I'm going to go for the FMS and start filling out everything in here. So it's an MD-82 with the 217A engines. IRAC cycle is current as of this recording. Right, we'll use the GNS1 position. That's totally fine. And our routing is from Echo Golf Kilo Kilo to Echo Hotel Alpha Mike. Let's see if we've got a company route for that. Yes, we do. Very good. Alright, departure runway 26 left, as we said earlier on for the ATIS. 26 left it is, and then for our routing, let's see, we've got Frayne as our first waypoint. So, there's probably a lot of different procedures available there, so, not 100% sure which one to expect. Let's go with the Frayne 1 mic for now, and we might have to change that later on. For now, I just want something in the box, and then we can still fill out the system later on. Amsterdam probably won it right, but tell you what, let's go on the safe side and collect an Amsterdam ATIS as well. So, Echo Hotel Alpha Mike, here we are, arrival ATIS, sent. By the way, I'm recording this the Sunday after Amsterdam has released, and I have to say the Dutch VACC is doing an incredible job here, staffing up an airport like that. I mean, it's for pretty much an entire week now. An entire week since the thing released, and they are still providing full ADC and going strong. That's really incredible. Okay, main landing runway 36 right, so we've got that set by now. Then let's go straight back into the messages. We'll go for the flight plan again and continue with our setup. So the arrival is from Redfar, so it's probably going to be a Redfar 2 Alpha arrival, if I'm not mistaken. Redfar 1 Alpha is fine as well. And that is for the ILS 36 right. Perfect. Okay, cool. So, activate, execute. Okay then, reserve fuel. Let me see what we've got. 2.4, which is for a diversion to Rotterdam. The weather isn't perfect, but it is alright. So, zero fuel, weight 51.4. We'll get rid of that. Okay, so, 51.4. Fuel, 6 tons, and we'll burn it on a normal schedule, and cruising level is 290. So, cruise wind is going to be 326 at 58. Unable cruise alt is so noted. Alright, and the ISA deviation, let's see if we've got that somewhere over here. OAT minus 44. Okay. Yeah, thank you. So, minus 44, and transition altitude 6001. Right, that's looking good. The performance we'll do later on when we've got our final values. So, speed 250 below 100 is looking good, and that shall be all for now. Right, cool. Let's continue with the rest of our pre-flight over here. So, we've got everything checked over here. Galley power can remain off for now, and then I am going to switch on the AC fuel pumps and then turn the start pump back off. That should probably have been off a little bit earlier, but I did make the experience, at least in my past experience, sometimes when I turned the start pump off, the APU would shut down again, and we certainly want to avoid that. Right, cabin temperatures are coming up to a nice level, let's go ahead and start the boarding. 150 passengers to go, so that's going to be a very quick one. Right, so today's the 15th of October, and our flight is going to be Martin Air 82. And it's the first leg of the day, insert for the flight recorder. So ACAS messages can be reset. Let's do a couple of warning system checks down here. Any skid, put it into test. Observe the four any skid lights coming on the flight warning panel. Stall system test. Overspeed test. And then the ISFOD test. And once again, you can see four indications down there, which is what we're looking for. Alright, very good. So then we can continue a little bit up here. Engine sync is off. GPWS test. And the wind shear test. Also notice how the flight director modes are changing to wind shear thrust and wind shear for the vertical mode, providing you with wind shear escape guidance. Right, cool. So, coming down to the pressurization panel, let's quickly lock that out. So, 0 feet is looking good, and then we can quickly have a look into the Amsterdam ATIS for the local QNH to be sure that we've got that set correctly, and it is 1021 hectopascals. Well, that's quite an increase. 2 days ago I flew there and we had 9.94, now it's 1021, so certainly the weather is improving now. Which is quite good, being able to fly there in good weather conditions, occasionally from time to time as well. Alright then, as for the FGCP altitude, I'm going to go with 4000 at first and the heading onto 260. And then when we check the charts in a few moments, then we can have a look into some more details. Okay. Fire test. And the bell cutoff is working as well. Looking good, and thrust modes are tested, looking good. Going down to the weather radar, we can select weather and turbulence over here. Quick check that the trim is working as well, which it is. I'll start with a standard IFR score 2000, and then for our flight ID, that is what ATC sees on their displays of us. We are Martin Air, Mike Papa Hotel 82. And now we gotta wait a little bit, so H2 Echo, here we go. Enter that. Very good. So frequencies, it's gonna be 1 to 1.5 on the COM2 standby, and then I'll wait a little bit with going to the delivery frequency so that we've got a little bit more silence before we actually start the flight. Alright, down here, auto brake, takeoff, arm, and the pneumatic transfers are open already. And with that, our preparations are pretty much complete. EFIS, I'm gonna go for a 10-mile range for now, and that is with the data. Okay, very good. So that is our preparation pretty much completed down here. Let's quickly grab a couple of charts using the Navigraph charts. Also, we can already put it into toga mode down here, looking good. So, unload my last flight, and I'm looking for the current one, please. Import. And that's Gatwick to Amsterdam. Here we go. So, synchronize my transplants, and then you can give me the frame 1 mic departure, which is kind of what we have been expecting here as well. In terms of our navigation then, let's go ahead and set the localizer frequency 110.9 on nav number 2 so that we can back up our initial turn. And then it's going to be a right-hand turn onto radial 259 inbound dead link 17.3, and I'm going to put that active on nav 1 with a course over here as well, 079. Pretty much like so. Okay, and that's it. Initial climb, well, 4,000 is our first limit we have over here, 220 knots. 220 knots means we most likely need to leave the slats out for the initial climb, but that is fine with us as well. Okay then, let's cross-check the FMC data, making sure that that's all correct as well. So, straight at 2.3 miles, that's the Bravo point, looks good. 220 knots maximum, above 1,500 feet, and we've got the upper limit covered by this 4,000 below over there. That's a right-hand turn, 31 miles deadling on a 079 inbound versus 078 over here. And that is maximum 220 above 3,200, we've got that. Then straight at 2090 meter deadling, that's 2 miles in here on 079. Speed max 250 below 4,000, we have that. Then same track, 13 miles to 13.6 to Acorn, that's 14 Acorn. And that is at 5,000 feet, and then it's gonna be a right-hand turn on to 096 for 12 miles to 31.9 Dover, so we've got Dover 32 in here, that's good enough. And there is no restriction on that. Left-hand turn to Detling VOR at 5,000, looks good. And then 013, 5 miles to Frayne at 6,000, which is what we have in here as well, looking good. Alright, speed max 250 below 100, unless otherwise authorized, we've got that in here as well. Okay, so that should pretty much be everything we need in here. So, that note over here is interesting. In order to alleviate airspace congestion, pilots may be offered SITS DAGA 1 mic or 1 Victor at a late stage of taxiing. Pilots unable to accept must inform ATC and will be allocated frame 1 mic and Victor or frame 1 Victor. Transition altitude 6,000, we've got that as well, and on when instructor control report, call sign SIT designated current altitude and initial cleared altitude. Okay, that is what we'll do. Perfect, so that is the review of the SIT completed. So up next, I would say we can go ahead and perform our departure briefing, and for that I am going... Well, I don't have any... I don't have any actual data for our McDonnell Douglas briefings, so I'm going to do it the ABBA style, which works quite well. We did all the FMC checks, all that stuff, so we are going to start on the pilot monitoring side then. Gatwick 26 left departure, frame 1 mic departure, climbing initially 4,000 feet, and the MSA on that one is going to be with the highest 2,300, so 3,000 keeps us safe. Extra fuel and time, we do have approximately 5 minutes of extra, should be sufficient. Hotspots of planned taxi route, well, to be honest, I don't see any. Can I have that chart, please? Thank you. Okay, so there is one over here where we got to make sure that we run into the correct routing. Hotspot number 3. Do we have anything on the chart for that? Yeah, here it is. Potential routing error, pilot taxiing eastbound on Juliet, shall be aware the taxiway deviates to the north at this point, okay? So I don't expect that we're going to go eastbound on Juliet, but this is what I mean. You've got Juliet here, and then it's running up here and continues here. So if you continue straight, you end up from Juliet into Zulu. We don't want to do that. Okay, stop margin reject the takeoff is going to be something around 1,000 meters. Engine out, sit straight at 25 miles, climbing 3,000. Immediate return is possible, and special operations, we're going to keep the flaps in one for our initial turn until we can accelerate past 220 knots. Do you see any threats for the departure? No, me neither. That's the departure briefing complete then. Alright, let's start with the cockpit crew checklist. DFDR set, HRS alignment is checked, FMS set, emergency lights, test numbed. No smoking on, windshield heat is on, engine sync off, stall warning tested, air condition supply on, position and strobe light, I keep forgetting that one, is in the both position. The fire protection tested, TRI tested, fuel quantity 5,950 kilograms, altimeters, QNH 1026, reading 220, cross-checked, fuel shutoff closed, and cabin pressurization auto. Cockpit crew checklist complete. Alright, cool, so that's our preparation mostly completed. Let's go ahead and grab our IFR clearance. So, we've got information, hotel. Okay. Pre-flight, departure request, so gate is 105, we've got ATIS Hotel, and we're sending that to Echo Golf, Kilo, Kilo, here we go. Free text. Good morning. And the EOBT we can say is gonna be at 30. Okay, so EOBT is 1130. Alright, cool. Looks good. We'll send that out. Alright, departure request is sent. So, received messages. Let's wait and see what we are going to get. And in the meantime, we had a call from the cabin. That's probably boarding completed. Yeah, it is. Boarding is complete. Very good. Right, let's say hello to the passengers. Ladies and gentlemen, very good afternoon from flight deck. This is your captain speaking. My name is Emmanuel, and in the name of Martin Air, you're all welcome aboard our flight 82 leading towards Amsterdam. Flight time 50 minutes, expect a smooth flight at 29,000 feet. We'd like to thank you all for being our guests today. Sit back, relax, enjoy the flight with us. If that's anything we can do for you to make it more enjoyable, don't hesitate to ask any of our cabin crew. Again, thank you for being our guests, and welcome aboard. Alright, that's the passengers catered for. Then I would say we can slowly start pointing GSX into the right direction. Prepare for pushback and departure. However long that is going to take eventually. So, pushback is in progress, very good. Alright, so we've been on the APU the entire time, so we don't need to change power anymore. That is fine. So let's just see if the PDC is going to come, or if we have to request clearance by voice. I could very well imagine the latter to be the case, so let's pre-tune delivery frequency already, 121.805. Let's have a quick listen there anyway, to see how busy it actually is. Alright, it does look rather busy, so for that reason I'm probably going to go straight across. Catwick delivery, good morning, Martin A to Echo information, hotel request clearance to Amsterdam. It's an MD-82 on 105, and I suppose you did not get the PDC request?
Negative.
Roger, then we're ready, copy on voice. Frame 1 mic departure, squawk 0362, Martin Air A2 Echo.
Martin Air A2 Echo, correct.
Alright, Squawk 0632, and we are going to turn that one on since we are about to ask for a clearance anyway. And then, let's see, frame 1 mic departure as cleared 0632, that is what he said, yeah. I typed that incorrect in here, 0632. Okay, cool. Then let's go ahead with our performance real quick. So, weight and balance, we've got takeoff weight 57,123, so make that 57.5 for the performance. Gatwick dry 26 left, QNH is 10, what did I say, 26? 1026, temperature 9, and the wind. We'll take it calm to be on the conservative side here. Okay, temporary runway shortening, let's make that 200 meters so that we can accept the intersection. And then 57,500 is going to be our takeoff performance. So, flap 6.5, and 50 degrees select the temperature. So let's start with that. Go for toga over here, and that's 50 degrees. And then 6.5 degrees flaps. There we go, 6.5, and we'll tune that in here as well. Right, 6.5, very good. So, takeoff speeds 135, 140, 149.
Ground, good morning, Tomjet 4590, type A 322, understand
135, 140, and 149. And then we can select 169 on the speed bug. Alright, that's all set. Very good. So, cabin calling, yeah, we don't have time for you right now, but... Alright. So, that's pretty much the setup done. Then gross weight 57.2 and the CG. Where do we have that? Here you go, CG.
Requesting IFOX, sir.
Here's 11.7.
A filed information hotel 820 NEO.
Here you go, 11.7 is set. So let's put that into the flight recorder. Takeoff weight 57.2 and the CG 11.7. What did I say?
Departure, squawk 3533, easy 322.
And the zero at the end, insert, written in, perfect. Right then, looking good. Then, I suppose, we can go ahead and let's see how far GSX is with the pushback preparations. Looks good, he's ready. Alright. Martin Air 82 Echo requests startup and pushback.
Martin Air 82 Echo, port position squawk 0362.
0362, and you are ready anytime. What's that thing doing? Zero? Oh, look at that! Zero? Six? But it inserts a 7. Why is it doing that? Clear that out completely, please. So, 0. What is that doing? It's always typing the wrong squawk. 0, 6, 3, 2. Is that working now? Strange. Martin A2 Echo is still standing by for pushback. Is there any reason we can't do that on the pushback? 0632, that is it.
Martin, Echo, can't give you pushback clearance before you walk.
Okay, so just confirm 0632, Martin Air 82
Echo. Martin Air 82 Echo, Ava.
That is exactly what we've said.
Still not seeing it on my screen. Do you mind trying to disconnect and reconnect in quickly to see if it fixes it? I've seen that happen once before.
Roger, will do. Okay, so I locked off and on again. I mean, the transponder is doing somewhat strange things today.
Was that 83457?
But I really don't know why that is happening now. Yeah, we are on the correct page. 0632 is in. That is strange. That's really strange. Why does ATC not see our squawk?
Clear to IB for 111X-ray. Squawk 766.
Okay, well, let's see if we can get clearance in a moment.
CBR 2294, get the ground ready.
Martin A2 Echo, you see the squawk now?
Martin A2 Echo, stand by, no, I don't see you on the departure list.
Oh, lovely.
CBR 2294, stand by. Okay.
That's about how well everything can go, huh? Okay, I suppose we'll just turn the beacon on already so that everything gets clear behind us.
Martin Air 82 Echo, see you now. 705 push start approved.
105 push start approved, face east, Martin Air 82 Echo, finally.
Edward Brown, hello, Pokemon 8445.
Alright, well. I suppose if that's all we can do, then that's all we can do. Cool, so, parking brake is released, you guys can start the push, and then we'll do the B4 star checklist.
CV104 Juliet, standby, brake.
It's an odd day, we're gonna use System B. B4 star checklist, parking brake and pressure. Released and checked, pneumatic pressure, 42 PSI. Engine ignition set on B, tank pumps on. Seatbelts on, anti-collision light on, APU norm econ switch is in norm. Okay, galley power off, pneumatic cross feeds open, and thrust levers idle. Before start checklist complete. Right, starting engine 2.
And
2?
All pressure. Did you get my request for clearance?
And 1?
We've got 2394, get the ground. Yeah, I did. I'm checking your flight plan.
Roger.
CV104, Juliet, hold position, due aircraft position back behind you.
Right, 20%, fuel on. Okay, that is a good start on engine 2. Let's start engine 1.
And 2,
all press. And 1. Brake set.
3294, that was Bordeaux Airport, LFBD.
And here we go.
That was for speedboat 321, sorry. Brake, speedboat 321, say again.
All right.
Speedboat 321, roger, you filed to Innsbruck with an, so you need to refile.
All right.
I would suggest you refile it with an...
That is two good starts. So you're clear disconnect, placing on the left side with the pin. Interesting, the parking brake seems to be inverted here. Wow, I was wondering why GSX didn't do anything. Okay, two good starts. Then let's go for it. Gully power, ignition, feeder and static heaters, anti-ice are not needed today. Then air conditioning supply. Is on, and then APU. Can come off. Alright, hydraulic system, we're gonna switch those on as well now. And then flaps, we're looking for a 6.5 degree takeoff. And finally the trim.
222 requesting taxi.
222 taxi kilo hold short Papa.
Right. Trim is set, windows are locked, and with that I'd say we go for the flight control track. That's full up, full down, neutral, full left, full right, neutral, full left, full right, neutral. Okay, after start checklist. Electrical system checked, galley power on, engine ignition off, heater and static heaters uncapped, anti-ice off, air conditioning supply is auto, door lights out, hydraulic system on and high, after start checks complete. Martin Air 82 Echo, request taxi.
Taxi kilo hold short, Papa.
Martin Air 82 Echo. Right, so kilo hold short, Papa is basically straight out, hold short off the crossing taxiway. Clear left side, clear right side. Lights are on, brakes are off. Config.
Taxi Papa hold short kilo.
Checked. Look at how quickly the EGT responds. That certainly doesn't seem right to me. Okay, we seem to be number 2 behind the EZ. But
Papa
so far it's hold
short.
I'm going to turn the north light off here to indicate to the EZ that we're stopping indeed.
Papa at Alpha November.
So Papa's a crossing
taxiway. Holding point Alpha November, Alpha 3 via Papa Alpha November, EZ 222.
Martin Air 82 Echo, after the EZ 8320 passes, select the right on Papa, taxi holding point Alpha 3 via 226, left on Papa and Alpha November.
Papa Alpha November, holding point Alpha 3, runway 26, left after the easy, Martin Air 82 Echo.
Ground hello, Echo on
Julia. Okay, cool. Clear left, clear right, let's go. Might as well set the Echo's displays here. That looks good to me. Okay, airplane, get going currently. Here we go, that looks better. Okay then, we should be ahead of the All Nippon. He sat behind the EZ, which is going now.
Into Bordeaux Airport via the Buckner 1 X-ray departure. Squawk 3421 with information hotel QNH1026. Speedbird 3294 with the rear weight for me.
Alright, straight ahead. Alpha November is over there. That's going to be a left turn.
124.230 for tower EZ 222, thanks.
Martin Air 82 Echo, contact at hotel 124.230, bye bye.
124.230, Martin Air 82 Echo, bye bye.
And anyone can get to the taxi holding.
Gatwick Tower, Martin Air 82 Echo, good morning. Alright, so taxi checklist. TRI, ART. All that is going to go off. Then VBox. Oh, that's why we read the checklists. Alright, so VBox are now set. Flight guidance system is set. Flaps and slats. That is 8 green light. And then takeoff briefing and data. Left seat takeoff. Runway 26 left. Flaps 8. Noise abatement. Actually, flaps 6.5. Noise abatement procedure 2. And we contact departure when advised by the Gatwick Tower. Emergency straight out, 25 miles, climb at 3000. Sit straight out, right hand turn. Any questions? Nope, taxi checklist complete. Gatwick Tower, Martin Air 82 Echo, good morning. Okay, that doesn't sound like we're getting a reply. Let's go back and confirm the frequency. So 1-2-4-2-3, Alpha here is just over here. All right. Right, that seems to be it.
Clear for takeoff 26 left, easy 2-2.
Captain Tower, good morning, Martin Air 82 Echo ready.
Martin Air 82 Echo, get one tower. Hello, behind departing EasyJet, EC20, line up, so my 26 left behind.
Go on, departing EasyJet, line up 26 left behind, Martin Air 82 Echo. Cabin crew, prepare for departure. Okay, before takeoff checklist, trim, 0, 0, and why is my engine going off? No. Come on. Serious? I'm out now, 8 to echo, we need to cancel our readiness. We need to hold position over here. Hold in position, Martin, 8 to echo. Might take about 3 or 4 minutes. If you've got anyone behind and can send them to a different holding point, that might help. Okay, so that engine just shut off. Because for some reason it assumed that I wanted to turn the fuel lever off. I certainly didn't intend to do that, but tell you what, that means we got to do a crossbleed start here. Okay, so we need the conditional procedures, I suppose they're called. Let's see if we can find anything in here in that manual. So trying to find them in the manual right now, but looks like they aren't in this one. Give me a second and we'll have the crossbleed engine start procedures ready in a moment, and otherwise we are just going to otherwise I suppose we are just going to try and improvise. Not a good idea in the MD-80, but you never know. Okay, so power plant crossbleed start, obviously that is not in the manuals anywhere. Okay, well, nice. If I can't find it in the manuals, then what I am going to do is where's the crossbleed valve? I believe that was somewhere over here. This is the fuel. No, obviously it's down here. Okay. So we are just going to improvise that. That's going to be funny. Okay, so that is the packs off. That is the crossbleeds open. Then, engine number 2 is working. Let's increase thrust on that one a little bit. Let's see if we can get start pressure. We need 42 psi up here. So just increasing my engine power until we've got 42. Ignition system B. Let's see, plane is holding. Alright, here we go. So, let's start engine 1. And 2. All pressure. And 1. Sometimes the simulator is just like, I'm using my mouse to look around and all of a sudden it registers that I want to turn off a fuel lever. Why is that? What is wrong with Microsoft Flight Simulator? Okay, anyway, our engine is running up. I suppose we don't need any warm-up time, the engine has been running. Okay, here we go. So thrust back to idle. Close the crossbleed valves. Engine bleeds can come on. And I believe that is everything we did. Martin Air 82 Echo ready for departure.
Okay, 2 Echo, correction, runway 26 left, clear for takeoff. That has been 3-4 and V the plan
enough. Runway 26 left, clear for takeoff, Martin Air 82 Echo. Alright. I suppose that's what you can do, huh? Then, before takeoff checklist. And this time, I'll make damn sure not to touch that fuel lever. Okay, trims. 0, 0, and set. Fuel heaters. Off APU air. Off pneumatic crossfeed. Closed. Brake temperatures. Down here. Checked. Engine ignition, both EOAP checked, ART inop is expected. Before takeoff checklist complete. Alright, man, that was exciting. I certainly didn't expect that to happen. Interesting, this is maximum tiller deflection I'm getting right now. Yeah, welcome to Maximum Flight Simulator. Okay, takeoff. Don't need that chart anymore, but we do need that clock. Interesting lineup, no comment. Okay then, stabilized, set takeoff thrust. Takeoff thrust set, indications normal. Clamp. 80 knots, checked. V1. Rotate. Positive rate, full gear. Okay, V2 plus 20 looks good.
Nav.
122.8, not an A2 echo. Too bad, you guys were all on now when it started. Okay, autopilot on, so nav, VNAV. Flap 0, speed check, flap 0. Well, too bad, they were all online when I started the flight, and now it seems like approach center and everything are gone. Okay, well, so be it. Alright, we're gonna keep the slats. Let's see, the clean speed on this one right now is 229. So, yep, we're going to keep the slats out at first. Okay then, that also means it's going to be a little while until we can actually complete our after takeoff checklist. So what I do suppose is, without ATC online, well, let's put it the other way, with ATC online, that would probably give us an unrestricted climb. So I suppose we're just going to do the same over here. Initially something like 11,000. Okay, ES hold, and 220 as per the procedure. So 220 knots until the dead link 31 point, we can certainly do that. That's about 4 miles to run, and thereafter we can then accelerate and retract the flaps completely. In the meantime, let's turn the ART on, climb thrust, and yeah, the LS engines are almost at climb thrust, that is fair enough for me. So, good look on the TCAS as we are currently navigating outside the boundaries of our route, so we always need to carefully check the TCAS when we do that, but it does look alright to me at the moment. 2,500 feet a minute rate of climb is okay as well. Transition altitude, set standard. Standard cross check, passing level 6.3. Now, checked. Okay, about to reach dead link 31, let's go to 50. So, slat 0. Speed check, slat 0. And the slats are retracted. So then, trans pump off, aux pumps off, or aux pump off. So, did I put it into override accidentally? No. Okay, they're both off. The hydraulic pressure should be somewhat decreasing now. Once the engine pumps are in low. Okay, very good. So, that is looking alright after takeoff checklist. Brake temperature checked, landing gear, up no lights, flaps flats, zero and retracted, engine ignition off, fuel tank pumps on as required, altimeters 1013 cross checked, after takeoff checklist complete. Okay, so we are going to do the climb out at first, and then when we are safely outside the immediate range of Gatwick, I will tell you a little bit about the crossbleed start procedure that I just improvised, and a little bit about how those bleed systems generally work, so that you know how I came up with the procedure as we executed it in the end. There is some certain logic to it, but for now, that shall suffice. Passing 10,000, lights going off, and I would say the weather is certainly good enough that we can release our passengers as well. Seatbelts auto, no smoking auto. Continue the climb, looking for flight level 290. Like so. Alright. Very quick word here, by the way. You can see that there are still loads of restrictions on our departure in terms of altitude. So down here we've got 5,000, 5,000, 6,000, and that is still all the way over here to Frayne. Oh, come on. Would you be so kind? Nope. Okay. So all the way to Frayne over here, which is like 30 miles to run from here. Now, in real world, you would file the flight plan with 6,000 feet at Frayne, and thereafter you would file for the further climb. Now, in the SimBrief doesn't do that. And that means what SimBrief is doing is that it's calculated with a continuous climb. In other words, when you are flying on some really busy events, then you should probably take into account that your SIT might keep you lower and therefore might keep your fuel usage higher than what you are seeing at the time where you are planning the flight. In other words, your fuel usage might be increased considerably on a sector like this. That's also the reason why the airplane told us that it would be unable to make flight level 290. You can see optimum is 280, but that is based on the 6,000 restriction over here at Frayne. So since we are not obeying that one, we can climb to a higher level as well. Let's go ahead and delete all these restrictions here, and then you will quickly see. Let's get rid of those. Over at Acorn we are now. And I would have expected the optimum altitude to rise right now, but okay. Well, it's going to be fine either way. Okay, we're outside all those speed restrictions, so let's go back to VNAV. We've deleted the climb restrictions, so FMS EPR and VNAV climb are active. And I do suppose, with a quick look into the TCAS, if we increase the range a little bit, that's the maximum we're going to get. No traffic in the area, so let's go ahead, take a little shortcut, and see what we can go to. No ETC online till the Dutch border, so I do suppose if we go direct to something like Radlo, that, as far as I remember, Radlo is the border to the Netherlands. But tell you what, let's take something a little bit closer, so something like Speer. I believe that is gonna cut the routing nicely over there. And just in case some ATC does come online, it's not going to cause too much of a havoc if we are off the file route. Alright, cool. So, I do believe with that pretty much everything is done that we could do over here. Lovely view on the MD-82, by the way. It is an awesome looking airplane. In my opinion, one of the most underrated ones. So, if you're still in the video at this point, then do let me know in the comments below. And do let me know what you think about the Leonardo MD-80 that we are flying over here. In my opinion, one of the most underrated aircraft that we have in Microsoft Flight Simulator. In terms of system, it is very close to perfection. There is not much that they could actually improve on the aircraft. The model is looking quite good as well. Unfortunately, frame rate isn't that good, but I suppose that's because of all the details they put into the 3D model over here. At least that is kind of my expectation. And overall, it is a beautifully flying aircraft as well. The only thing, in my opinion, that could see some improvement there is the sounds, but I've done a video on that topic in the past. And, by the way, where are you flying, my friend? Come on. Send me direct to Dagger or Gaysap. I tell you what, we're gonna go direct to Radlo. So flying severely outside the boundaries of our route, That means we need to be very careful for any traffic, and if there is anybody popping up on our TCAS who we might be running into, then we are going to be the ones avoiding them because we are flying off route. That's just a little bit of my personal little philosophy here, flying in VATSIM in Unicom airspace. But, you know, everybody's doing that different as well, and who knows if the other guy might even be on their route. You never know. Okay, so that's going to be like a 40-mile cruise over there, perfectly fine for us. So, I wanted to talk about the pressurization and the bleed air system for our engine start. So, let's assume a couple basic things here. We're going to start with the basic architecture of the bleed air system in pretty much any commercial jetliner. It doesn't matter if it's a Boeing, if it's an Airbus, if it's a McDonnell Douglas, or whatever it is. They're basically built all the same way. You've got three bleed sources, which are engine 1, engine 2, and APU. Now, any of those can be interconnected. So, for the situation we were in, there were two options when engine 1 just spooled down. So, we could either have started the APU and restarted the engine with the APU following normal start procedures, or we could do a cross-bleed engine start. Now, I opted to go for the cross-bleed start. There's one thing to consider when you're doing that, and that is there anything behind you? Because if there is, you need to be a little bit more careful with increasing your thrust. You could see we had like 60% N1 at the end of the cross-bleed start, which is quite a bit. Normal taxi N1 is in the regions of about 40 to 50% N1, so 60% is a lot. Now, basically, in order to start the engine, you need a minimum pressure in the bleed air system. An engine in idle is usually not going to provide sufficient bleed air in order to produce that pressure. On the MD-80, you can see the start pressure right over here, and you need 42 PSI, so just over the 4 marker over here. Now, the basic procedure we needed to do is this. Shut off the packs and open the cross-bleed valve. Now, cross-bleed valve on the MD-80 is two valves, one on each side, and To be honest, I never really understood exactly how that system works on the 80, so I just opened both of them and then it worked totally fine. So now we just needed to increase engine thrust to reach the desired start pressure of 42 PSI, and when that was available, then we could simply proceed with a normal engine start without the need to do anything special. And that is how I conducted the cross-bleed start. Now, after that, we need to be very careful in reconfiguring the airplane for our normal envelope. Now, there's two things to consider over here. One is the normal systems configuration, so basically remember everything you did and undo it. In other words, packs on, starter, cutout, and close the cross-bleed valves once again. But then the second one that we always need to worry about is the engine warm-up requirement. Now, most aircraft actually have such a requirement, but on most jetliners it is 2 or 3 minutes only, so by the time you've completed your after-start checklist in taxi to the runway, that time is over. So engine warm-up requirements normally don't matter too much if you are flying a typical airline. Where they do start to matter is when you are doing something like this, starting an engine directly at the runway. Now, this mostly comes into consideration when you are doing a single engine taxi out and then you start the remaining engine at the runway, where you need to make sure that you actually take consideration of your engine warm-up requirement. Now, in our case, things were a little bit different. Since the engine has been running for several minutes before it actually shut down, we could simply delay that part and we could simply skip over the warm-up requirement because the engine basically was warm already. So that really wasn't too much of an issue. Now, engine warm-up requirements, you might be wondering about why are those needed at all. Well, mostly in order to get some of the parts to operating temperatures and not subject them to too much of a thermal difference when all of a sudden you set takeoff power, the engine internally goes up to 1000 degrees centigrade. If you do that on cold metal, like if you've literally just started the engine and then you put it to over 1000 degrees internally, keep in mind the EGT over here is the exhaust gas, inside the combustion chamber, temperatures are much higher than this, so 1000 degrees can easily be observed inside the combustion chamber, in some engines even 1300. So don't do that on a cold metal, it's just going to break the engine. Similarly, the oil needs to warm up so that it can flow normally inside the engine, once again protecting it from any sort of damage arising while you are prepping for, or while you are running the engine at a high power. So that's just the normal kind of stuff that you need to worry about when you're flying an engine like this. Obviously, as I mentioned, on most jet aircraft, it's by far not as much a problem as it is on piston aircraft. So when you're flying piston aircraft, especially something like a DC-6 or something, like one with those old engines that were really, let's call it, boosted all the way to the maximum power you could somehow get out of it without destroying the engine. Those were where things really started to matter with those engine warm-up requirements. Nowadays, with modern jet engines, it's not as much a problem anymore. Obviously, if this has happened in real life, you would have returned to the gate and had the engine inspected. You wouldn't just restart the engine straight at the gate and hope for the best, if you know what I mean. So, if, like in our case, we knew the reason for the engine shutdown, the fuel lever's been moved to the off position, I would still return to the gate, but then, in order to offload my first officer, who shut the engine down for no reason. I certainly would not want to fly with them anymore. But okay, that's just some of the basic theory going into it. Oh, plane is climbing through the cleared altitude. Go back down. Okay, alt hold. That's better. I forgot to pull the alt knob. Always keep in mind when you're flying the 80, yeah, why are you climbing? I was just about to say, always keep in mind when you're flying the 80 that you need to pull the altitude knob. Come on now, get me down. Alt capture. And kindly capture it this time. What is it doing? Why does it keep climbing? Okay, disregard the alt capture, we'll just go down 1,000 feet a minute. Thank you. Now we can pull it. Once again, alt capture. Okay, this looks better. This looks like it's doing what it's supposed to do. Alright then, received a contact me from London, 118.480. Let's go ahead and give him a call. London, very good morning, Martin Air 82 Echo, flight level 290, inbound Radlow.
Martin Air 82 Echo, London Control, which I maintain, flight level 290, when ready, descent flight level 230 by register.
Martin Air 82 Echo, sorry, that was unreadable, say again.
Martin Air 82 Echo, maintain flight level 290, when ready, descent flight level 230 by register.
Maintain 290 when ready to send 230 by RATFA, Martin Air 82 Echo. Okay, that's what we've got in the FMC anyway, 230. And I suppose with altitude hold now finally having engaged, let's go back to VNAV and then flight level 230. And this time I'm just going to alt straight away so that alt note is available over there.
Roger.
Yep, that's what happens when you come back to an airplane after a while not flying in. Okay, so 15 miles to a top of descent, that is not a lot really, so let's go ahead and start with our arrival preparation. Even though we'll probably have some level segments in there after RATFA, but tell you what, it surely doesn't hurt just to get the charts out and get the entire thing ready over here. Maybe get an updated ATIS as well to see what we're up to.
So,
request, ATIS, arrival. Echo Hotel Alpha Mike. Here we go, sent.
The flight mode is given on control, leave my airspace now. One of the come on, 1 2 3, definitely.
ATIS, Amsterdam, information India, main landing runway 36 right, main departing runway 36 left. Transition level 40, wind 010 at 4, slightly variable. Visibility 10 or more, clouds few, 2,800 cumulonimbus, get up 4.5, temperature 9, QNH 1021 hectopascals. So we remember transition level is 4.0, let's go ahead and start prepping that stuff. That's 4.0 going in here. And then for the arrival, we can select ILS 36 right. That's the one. Okay, final protocol 002 and the frequency 111.95.
Logistic 905 to Papa.
Papa 195 and 0, 0 2, like so. Right, about reaching our top of descent, let's go ahead 2 miles and press VNAV.
Negative, no star, leave Abbott heading 260 degrees.
Here we go, okay. VNAV descent. So now we're under ATC control, now we better make sure we're not overshooting our levels anymore, so Alt is armed. Alright, so next up we can do 250 below 10,000, like that, and remove this, execute, forecast, I'll leave the winds out, you can see they're mostly coming from the side, so they aren't going to have much of an effect anyway. For the arrival itself, let's have a quick look at that. Starting in Alpha Mike 636, which we've got in here, 2,000 feet, speed 170 is looking good. And then down to a minimum of 217, that's 228 above the ground. So let's go ahead.
125.75,
Martian A2 Echo, see ya.
Griffin 2733, London.
I'm sorry, I'm good. Morning, Martin Air 82 Echo descending level 230 inbound Redfar.
Martin Air 82 Echo, good afternoon. Proceed
direct to Sugol, expect a 36 right. Alright, Sugol, 36 right,
Martin Air 82
Echo. NG. Hey. Alright, Sugol, here we go. As I mentioned, a little bit below the profile right now. I tell you what, let's do 2,000 feet a minute. As I still want to reach level 230, more or less a beam Redfar. However, it's not an exact restriction anymore since Redfar isn't on our route anymore, but just want to be on the safe side here. Okay, so minimums are set 228, and that is in now. As for the speeds, let's grab the landing data card over here. 55.3, so we might as well go for the 55 ton card. And we're going to set our box from that. Okay, very good. So that's 1,000 go. Alt capture is armed. Or rather, alt capture is on. And speed restriction, let's go a little bit more, let's make it 300 so that we're actually not blocking any other traffic. I know that VATS and pilots do like to fly very fast. After Sugol, we'll get radar vectors, most likely direct Sierra Papa Lima at first, and thereafter vectors. Something the likes. Always hard to determine exactly what they're up to, at least if you're flying somewhere far from your home base. Okay then, descending so we can turn the hydraulics on, switch the auto thrust to go around. Why did it go into clamp now? Here we go, speed 300, leveling off nicely, very good. TCAS into the below mode, and I do believe with all of that we can quickly stow the dial of flap selector, like that. And then we can read the descent checklist. So, approach and landing briefing. Yeah, we talked about it on the way in. So, performed, flight guide system set, TRI go around, landing data is confirmed, VBUX set, altimeters cross checked, 1013, hydraulic system, obstrans high, pressurization is checked, descent checklist complete. So as I mentioned earlier, we are going to fly level a little bit here in 230 before they ask us for further descent, so... When ready, descent level 100, Martin A2 Echo. That's what I mentioned. So what I'm going to do is go to the cruise page, and then we'll re-enter our cruising level 230, like that. Okay, and it doesn't do it. That's unfortunate. Can we maybe trick it over the performance init page? Cruising level 230. Oh, it's in already. Okay, here we go. New top of descent. So we tricked it via the performance page. That is good enough for me. In that case, VNAV, Alt. It's reducing 287 knots. Yeah, that's fine for me. There is nobody behind us. That's the most important thing for us to check when we are changing our speed in the trees. Alright, cool. So, we are pretty much all set up now. Very good. 15 knots to run. So I do suppose we should just have cruised at 230 or something the likes. Would have made the flight a little bit less of a parabolic trajectory, but tell you what, it's fine like that. As so weather radar, let's go like something like one down. The MD-80 does have a weather radar simulated over here, however it is the standard Asobo radar, so you're just getting a 2D top-down view without any noticeable detail that might be of any use. Again, in Maxar Flight Simulator, looking outside the window is still the best weather radar that we have available. However, in the real life, that is sometimes the case as well, especially on the Interview Radar 4000 that we had a lot in my old airline's fleet. That thing often just lied to you. You know, you had a green indication somewhere on the weather radar display, like we have it right down here. Something in green, you fly towards it, and all of a sudden, you know, all of a sudden the thing turns amber, like 5 miles before. You think like, yeah, okay, you can still go through that. And then 1 mile before the weather cell, when you've got no way of deviating anymore, it just turns red. So, as long as we've been flying in daylight VMC, my primary weather radar was always just looking outside the window and gathering my data from there. However, when flying at night, you know, you just have to get a little bit more used to the way the system works, and just get a little bit more used to how it works, and then you could handle it as well. Luckily, in the A330, and as well as on the old weather radars we had on our 737s, the thing is a lot more reliable, and I couldn't figure out any such problems over there. But that's just a little antidote there, talking about weather radars. Okay, here we go. So, you should be descending any moment. Still at VNF level. Do I need to push it now? Yeah, VNF descent. That's strange. On the previous one, it started the descent on its own. On this one, I need to press the button again. I wonder why that is. If anybody of you knows, if we've got any experts on the MD-80 series in the among our viewers, then I would absolutely appreciate if you could shed a little bit of light into it. In the meantime, we're descending down towards level 100. Landing on 36 right, so that's something we haven't done yet in the sim. We did fly the circling from 36 right onto 04, but I suppose we are not going to do something that likes today. But we got to remember telling ATC that we're a passenger flight. Because I did one smaller trip in preparation for recording this video with the MD-80, also a Martin Air flight. And in that one, it turned out they mostly see Martin Air as cargo aircraft these days, which the modern Martin Air is, to be honest. But the old Martin Air, operating the MD-80, still had passengers, so for that reason, we'll have to tell ATC that we want to park at a passenger gate, and not at the cargo terminal. Something to keep in mind when you're flying an airline that used to do something, but no longer does it. But alright, so, we're nicely descending, about 20 minutes from our landing. Let's go ahead and turn the seatbelt signs on again. Martin 8 to Echo, descent level 70, Sugol, Sierra Papa Lima. Alright, that's pretty much as expected. Track required, I disagree. So, Sierra Papa Lima after Seagull. We'll do that. Here we go. Looks good. Execute. And after that, we'll have a discontinuity. That's fine. I'll just leave it. Because we will eventually get radar vectors. And once we get those, we're going to clean up the flight plan. However, that might make our indications here incorrect. Let's go vertical speed. Minus 2000, something of the likes. to be sure that we keep descending, because now the computer is calculating. Where is it? Okay, because previously the computer calculated from Sugo direct to the final, now it's calculating Sugo to the airport, outside to the final, and back. For that reason, our Vinov path isn't valid anymore. I suppose what we could do is Sierra Papa Lima, it wants to be in 4,000 there, so let's just give it a little bit lower, like maybe 2,000. Now we should probably get a better profile. See, now it indicates we're actually above the profile. So now it's recalculating.
Bye.
1-1-2-0-5. And we said we had ATIS India.
Approach and meet approach landing. Go around.
Yes, sir. Mr. 2 Juliet Kilo, watch your turn right heading 18 Kilo, maintain 3,000 feet.
2,000 feet, right heading.
Right heading 18 Kilo. 58 X-ray, speed 220 knots, please Papa Alpha Mike heading 210.
210
left and Papa Alpha Mike is 7210. 2 November, Covid Amsterdam,
quite busy once again.
1 Alpha Papa with
you? Hello,
Alpha Papa, climb by level 1-T0 identified.
Skipple approach, Martin A to Echo, level 125, descending 70, information India.
Pilot
36 right, descend flight level 40, Martin 8 to Echo. Okay.
66 Charlie, speed
20. And that's 40 set. So, doing a little bit of our own VNAV right now, but as you can see, reaching level 40 here, we might get radar vector somewhere over here, so that's going to give us like 10 extra track miles or so. And those 10 miles are all we need to get the speed down. So, our vertical speed is looking pretty much alright. We could obviously just go and just go into ES mode as well, seeing that our thrust is pretty much at the minimum already.
Let's
see, just a little bit we can pull off. Then we can start reducing speed to 50. Give us a little bit smoother aircraft movement here.
My very pilot just crashed, and I need to go back to runway 26 right.
I don't have too much scope, I think. Oh, there, 96 Foxtrot, hello, yes, turn left 90.
So, that's pretty much that.
92 Foxtrot.
Get a 1188, turn left heading 030, descend 2000 feet, clear that.
Still, bottom 10,000. Lights coming on, seatbelts are on, fuel pumps are looking good. We'll turn the no smoking on, advising cabin crew that we're now about 10 minutes from landing. Everything's turned on, everything's looking good, and 1-1.5 is being monitored still, and this luckily doesn't matter, otherwise we would not have been able to talk to ATC at all. Alright, cool.
Get a 66 Charlie, speed 180 knots. Want 5 Tango Romeo, komt de Schiphol Tower, 119 decimal 30, 16 feet on board.
119 230, we can pre-select that.
Want 5 Tango Romeo, bedankt op dienst.
Alright. Looks very good. So we're just waiting for the Q&H before we go to local altimeter setting, and then we can read the approach checklist.
KLM, 1 Alpha Papa, Kobe Amsterdam, 125-0750.
In the meantime, what we can do,
once
we're receiving the ILS signal, which is the case now, can listen to the Morse code in order to identify the ILS. The airplane is not doing that automatically for us. We got to do it ourselves. You can hear it very slightly in the background. It's really silent. But okay, let's assume the thing is identified. So I wonder how they're going to vector us. If they're going to take us across the field and then make us approach on a right downwind, or if they're going to turn us out to the left just prior to the field and make us fly a left downwind. But we'll see about it. Ultimately, it's quite hard to determine in order to maintain a constant descent approach, but I suppose there's not a lot we can do about it right now. About to enter some icing conditions here. So let's turn the engine any ice on and the ignition with that as well. Like so.
Departure with aid, Leipzig, 6 Mike Golf passing 4200 for 6000.
Okay, alt is armed.
Left direction, right heading 190.
Martin Echo, right heading 190.
Kelam
11,
Kelam
11, okay, heading south.
Kelam 11, reduce final approach speed.
Reduce final approach speed.
Leipzig Air 5, Mike Golf, climb for level 130.
Wait, was it for
Leipzig
6 Michael?
Leipzig 6 Michael, climb for level
1. 1,000 to go, alt armed. In the MD-80, it might be a good idea to adjust your call to make it 1,000 to go, alt armed, rather than, you know, keeping it the old-fashioned way. Okay, so, then let's go direct to Alpha Mike 626 with an intercept black, and that's going to be 002 for the inbound course, and execute. Right, now we've got the extended center line, and that looks good. So I'm going to keep the speed exactly as it is, and we are only going to reduce it once we actually get inside the, once we get an instruction from ATC, or once they vector us directly onto the final and clear us for the approach. That's the two reasons for us to start reducing the approach speed.
Right.
So what time are we supposed to be here?
35,
and it is now 26.
Speed
180, Martin A2 Echo. Right, that's what I meant. He is going to give us the speed restriction once he wants it. Okay, so 180 is a good speed for us. It means we can fly it with just the slats extended. We don't need the flaps at that. Flap speed is like 177 or so. Alright, so reaching our slat speed. And slats extend. Speed check. Slats extend. What you will notice, you've got this low limiter over here on the auto throttle, so it is not going to allow you to fly below the limiting speed of your present configuration, and that's something to take care of. You might just reduce the speed of 180 over here, but the plane might not necessarily let you go that slow. It could easily maintain the 225 or whatever that is over here, that it's calculated as its minimum clean speed. Nice. Request lower? Nope, you can reduce your speed. There's always the moment where you're sitting there in the cockpit and you go like, oh boy, if only I had said nothing. But that stuff certainly happens. Makes it fun as well, doesn't it? Right, 180 knots. So that's quite a bit of pitch over there, like 7 degrees right now, with only the slats extended, not the flaps. But the main difference there is extending the slats is going to increase the critical angle of attack, while extending the flaps is going to bring your nose down. So slats only doesn't help you too much with the pitch. Flaps would, But 7 degrees, totally fine. On the A330, in some occasions, we even go all the way to 9. So that stuff happens. Right, so still lots of stuff going on the TCAS over there. So it is certainly rather busy. This is maximum range for the TCAS and the MD-80 already, 15 miles, and you'll see the final is somewhat full. Blocked. Oh, lovely, but he doesn't listen anyway. Oh, there he is, okay.
Turn left.
Perfect. So, I suppose we don't need that tablet for now. So, to conserve a little bit of power. Blocked.
Left heading 0900,
Martin 8 to Echo. I suppose I hurt my call sign. That's why I just said block. Normally, you're not supposed to do it, but I thought in both cases that I hurt my own call sign. So, it is losing a little bit of altitude here in the turn. I suppose since we're flying rather close to the maximum angle of attack, you can see it from the pitch limit indicators coming up over there that we are pretty close to our maximum angle of attack. But then again, Martin A2 Echo, descend 2000, QNH 1022. Okay, set altimeter 1022.
Expecting 365 information
you have received,
descending.
And alt is armed, and then we can set 1022 up here as well. Approach checklist, cabin signs, on fuel system set, altimeters and bucks are second cross checked. Approach checklist complete. Right, tell you what, let's go ES mode. Silence that gear warning.
Left
030, clear ILS 36 right. Left 030, clear ILS
36 right,
Martin
8 to Echo.
Alright. Here we go, 15 miles out, clear for the ILS. That is the ILS mode armed.
709er, speed 180 knots.
1-8. You can see in this regime, the MD-80 really doesn't want to descend too much. It's giving us something between 500 and 1,000 feet a minute, and that is without any thrust on. See that? It's 500 feet a minute now. 600, 650, something like that. And we even fly 10 knots faster than we should. And I have a feeling we should start correcting for that in a few moments. Because the traffic over there really isn't that that far out, so tell you what, flaps 15. That is hopefully going to help the plane with a little bit of speed reduction here. Yeah, there we go. Now it's taking the speed back. And then probably going to maintain 180.
All
right. Cool, so 2,000 feet is missed approach, altitude is set already. Oh, it's descending a little bit quick.
Vertical
speed. So those flaps, as you can see, made a huge difference there. Alright, half a dot off the localizer, so that was not the best intercept it's ever done, but I suppose it is going to work for us. Alright. Runway track 002 set. And let's get the speed back 160 as soon as we're level in 2000. Come on. Oh no, it disarmed the alt mode once again. Come on, airplane. You can do better than that. Did anybody of you spot when the alt mode disarmed? Okay, alt hold.
Yeah, down to 3000 on 1022 and left 130.
Alright.
at least it's recapturing this time. If anybody of you spotted when this happened, then do let me know. I missed it. I totally missed it. Probably when I changed vertical mode, now that I'm thinking about it, but it's alright. So, how far is the preceding out? He seems to be getting closer, even though I reduced 160 already. Yeah, look at that. He's like 4 miles from us now. 2.5 is minimum they can do over here, so we should be going fine like that.
Echo,
119 decimal 230,
bye-bye.
119 decimal 230, Echo, bye. Skipper Tower, Martin Air to Echo, ILS 36 right.
Martin Air 8 to Echo, continue, break LM 58 X-ray, continue.
What kind of a call is that? Continue, Martin Air to Echo. The break phrase is really overused in VATSIM. You wouldn't need to do that in real life like that. Just Martin Air to Echo, continue. KLM, blah blah, continue. Why do a break in that? They're teaching that a lot on VATSIM, but in real life, it doesn't work like that. Okay, glide slope capture. Go around altitude set. Then we can pre-select the ground frequency, 121.805, because they have the automatic handover over here.
There
you go, 121.805. Okay, runway's inside up there. Then I will quickly prepare the taxi charter ready, so that we know where to go.
Runway 4, clear takeoff, 36 left.
Okay, 36 right, vacating left, so yeah, probably going to be something like Echo 2 or so.
Schiphol Tower, KLM 13 Foxtrot, on checklist.
All right, minimum selected. Right, 4 miles out.
Continue Victor 3, runway 36 left.
Gear down, flaps 28.
Victor 3, runway 36 left, KLM 13 Foxtrot.
So that's 134, makes it 139 for the final approach.
95 Charlie, taxi holding point, Victor 4, runway 36 left. Over there, Kremlin next
time. Okay, engine anti-ice can go off again. So, final checklist. Landing gear down, 3 green. Flap slats, 28 green light. Speed brakes, armed, engine ignition. Both EOAP checked, final checklist complete.
Nordic 616, runway 36 left, line up and wait, Victor 4.
Line up and wait, runway 36 left, Nordic 1.
Turkey is 2 Juliet Kilo, ground 11.805.
Okay, cool, so the Turkish is blocking the first exit, that means we'll let it roll to the second. Autopilot off, we'll do the rest ourselves, and I'll keep the auto thrust on because I find it a little bit hard to fly the MD-80 on manual thrust.
Martin Air 82, runway 36 right, clear to land, wind speed 40 degrees, 7-0.
36 right, clear land, Martin Air 82 Echo.
Nordic 616, runway 36 left, clear for takeoff, 340 degrees, 7-0.
Okay, approaching minimum.
Clear for takeoff, runway 36 left, Nordic 616.
Continue.
Tower could have been off 6 of
the average. Let's not dive below the path. Stay straight on it. Here we go, looking good.
Wait, runway 36 left, 6-4 behind.
Behind the departure, Nordic, line up runway 6-4 behind.
And we're down.
Passing to 2000.
Okay. Good break up, reverse normal. And that's both runway exits blocked. Okay. Auto break off, we let it roll. We need to. So those guys really need to get away from the exits quicker.
121.204 for the sensor traces from 8.25.
Because if somebody else was 2.5 miles behind us, then these guys would not have been able to
Oh, hello.
Okay,
get their landing clearance. Okay, well, I'll go into the high speed.
Landing up and wait, the runway.
In the opposite direction here. But that means I need to slow the airplane significantly in order to take the turn, which in turn means, yeah, just unnecessarily long wait on the runway here.
KLM 13 Foxtrot, runway 36 left, clear for takeoff, wind 340 degrees.
Okay, come on, airplane, keep rolling.
Clear for takeoff, runway 36
left.
Look at that!
Now it's all runway exits blocked.
Top Swiss 32 Zulu Foxtrot behind departing, KLM Dreamliner, line up and wait, runway.
Couple ground, hello, Martin 8 to Echo.
Hello, Martin 8 to Echo, taxi via Alpha to Bravo 24.
Well, Alpha Bravo 24, Martin 8 to Echo. Alright, so it's not because of the ground. Probably nobody of them reads charts and therefore doesn't know about the local procedure that you don't get a hand off, but you contact ground yourself after landing. That is standard procedure here in Amsterdam, but many seem to ignore it. Okay, so Bravo 24 is set. Where is that? All the way to the south. Okay. Ooh, and we should have taken the turn over here. That is Alpha. I'm on airplane. Turn.
This is Starlink again.
This is full tiller input right now. Certainly insufficient.
Yeah,
that is better. Sometimes I just don't understand Microsoft Flight Simulator and its physics. Okay, Bravo 24 is all the way down here at the Bravo Pier, so we're going to go all the way around. And that is it. Okay, cool. So let's start with the upper landing procedures then. Or first, while we are on a straight way, let's pre-select the other ground frequency, 121705.
Like that.
Okay, so that's off. The flaps can go back 25. Man, look at how busy it is here once again. It's just lovely, isn't it? Gonna put the APU into the run position, but not into the start yet. So, where's the Turkish going there?
Yeah, you are on the correct taxi. Taxi, correct taxi, going from the taxi.
Come on, Turkish. You gotta hold, we're coming from the right.
Yeah, okay, in that case, contact 121.980.
Hey, stop, Turkish, stop! Lovely! Yoohoo! Turkish Airlines! Hey, where's the Turkish going?
Yeah, my apologies for the Turkish, I'm not sure where he's going. He's not following his assignment route, anyways.
Oh, lovely.
Yeah, it's one of those days again.
Yep, certainly seems like it.
My apologies, sir.
Yeah, it's on YouTube for all the world to see now.
Well done. You can stand by on 611705 now.
Stand by 121705. I guess I don't need to ask whether KLM is going straight out on Alpha, or I just ask your colleague.
Yeah, you can ask my colleague.
Will do.
He will take care of you.
Hope so. Cool. Hello, Martin Air 7, correction, A2 Echo.
What is A2 Echo, low position?
Oh, come on. Can we just take Bravo?
Yes, yeah, stand by. First need to do some knowledge, low position for now.
Roger.
Spirit 22 X-ray, when clear of Lufthansa A320.
What are those guys doing? Okay, in the meantime, after landing checklist...
Martin 82 Echo, left Alpha 7 Bravo, switch back to Alpha by Alpha 4.
Alpha 7 Bravo, Alpha 4, Martin 82 Echo. Okay, Alpha 7 is right over here.
KM 66 Charlie, hello, contact ground 121805.
To go left here, first to the right.
Spirit 22 X-ray, Schiphol ground.
It's incredible, everybody's doing what they want today. And by the nose of that plane hanging up high, we can see that it's GSX messing up their pushback over there.
Lufthansa, 3 Echo Foxtrot, that's Alpha 6, join Bravo behind the Martin Air MD-82, and then continue via Bravo to Quebec.
Alpha 6,
now his
GSX
pushback is probably completed, as you can see by the airplane twitching over there.
Thank you. No problem, your pushback and startup is approved.
Okay, Alpha 4 is next to the right, and then we should be almost at our gate already. So Alpha 4 is over here, so we go back into Alpha, and then first to the right again. Even though it would probably have been easier just to go straight on Bravo all the way until...
Air 5 at X-ray, give way to the Lufthansa 820 coming from the right at Alpha 6.
Okay, so next to the left, and then first to the right again, and then we're almost at the gate.
Confirm KLM 6, 9 at Tango.
Confirm KLM 6, Tango, 6, 9 at Tango, issue.
Here go, okay, starting APU.
M6, 9 Tango, on your left hand side you'll see a Lufthansa 320 overtaking you. After he's joined Alpha, get
right
it on
then,
board.
Let's prepare GSX.
Three,
it's
six,
gonna be the Bravo pier.
Disky 5, cross one, question 36 center.
No, okay.
Sorry, we do take Alpha.
We try that again.
Alpha, we between
so, Bravo pier.
36 center. Sorry, we don't copy the time. So, after 36 center, I copy this.
Interesting, it's the same gate both times.
Standby for scale of 5 at X-ray, we'll get a gate change, for now we'll position
oh,
behind
okay,
KLM
then we don't have GSX available for our parking, so be it.
Holding behind KLM, I'm following KLM 5 at
X-ray. 5 at X-ray, expect Charlie 13.
Expecting Charlie
13, okay, so Bravo 24.
KLM 6, 9 at Tango, follow the Lufthansa 820 now, turning onto your taxiway.
There it
is. 436 left. By Quebec at Whiskey 5, cross 36 center.
Okay, lights going off, weather radar is off.
Roger, so KLM 6, 9 at Tango. I'll take you to all short runway 36 left via.
That's a French.
Alpha,
that is a French.
36 center. After that.
Very clear accent.
After that, you just follow the company in front of you.
Okay, Roger. And here we are.
2-2 X-ray, are we ready for the push start?
I suppose we don't have any stopping indicators, then I'm just gonna stop over here, it doesn't matter. Alright, cool, so after landing, check this real quick. Flaps slats 15 extend, and now that we've parked, we can already retract them. So, speed brake retracted, engine ignition is off, pitot and static heat is off,
and
NEIS is off. And radar off. Okay then. So the generators are available, galley power going off, and shut them down. This time for real, my dear engine number one. So let's see if we can at least set the squawk correctly now. 2000. Yeah, this is working. I really don't know why that didn't work on the previous sector. Okay then, thanks, getting rid of that, and then we can go ahead and secure the airplane, please. I'm gonna leave one pump on for the APU. Like that. Okay, cool, so parking checklist. Fuel tank pumps, one on, aux and trans hydraulics, I always forget about them. But we will need them anyway for now to open the door, so let's do that first. So, hydraulic pressure is needed to lower the stats at the back of the plane, and since this is a walk-in, walk-off stand, we are certainly going to do that. Okay, so, forward main, forward stair, well, why is that not working again? Aft stair maybe? Any of you? Anything? No? Hello? Okay. Well, if that doesn't work, I don't care, let's go ahead and shut it down, then they can off, then they can open the door with their muscle power. Okay, so, let's do the checklist once again. Fuel tank pumps, one on, oxygen, hydraulics off, off, and parking brake pressure set and checked. Alright, and that's the parking checklist complete. So a little bit of a troubled flight, but overall we did make it over here. The airplane is in one piece and it can still be used again even, so what else could you possibly be asking for? I've got no idea why I can't open the doors here, but I don't care. Alright, so that's gonna be it. So, we've just been run over by Turkish, we've just had a taxi around a KLM that almost tail-striked on their taxi. Apart from that, we had to restart the engine that shut down all by itself because of a... I don't know what happened there. I moved the mouse over the lever and all of a sudden the engine went off, so thanks to Microsoft Flight Simulator. But overall, I do suppose it was quite a nice flight. And looking outside, if I turn the anti-collision off, then I can probably open the doors as well. Yeah, look at that. I mean, that's not a door opening, but it is moving the right direction. That's all we care about, is it? Alright guys, so that's gonna be it for today's flight. Thank you very much for flying along. I do hope you enjoyed seeing the MD-80 once more. I certainly did, even though we had a couple of quirks flying the airplane, but overall it worked quite fine and it is just a magnificent airplane. So thank you very much for watching. I see you all again on the next one. In the meantime, be sure to leave a comment, let me know what you think about it. Leave a like as it does help with YouTube algorithms. And finally, if you are up for more, don't forget to subscribe to the channel. Thank you very much for watching everyone. And if you really loved my videos, I would appreciate a small donation through the Buy Me Coffee link in the video description below. In the meantime, thanks for watching and see you all again on the next one.